Morning.
Morning.
I have one more announcement to make that we didn't want to do on the video. I'd like to invite Paula Roan to come up. Paula is Reverend Paula Roan. She is an ordained deacon in the United Methodist Church, and she is coming on our church staff to be our nursery director to help form and teach and educate the youngest of ours about Jesus. So I just wanted to introduce her to all of you, and if we could welcome her to the church this morning. I'm excited to hear what the band has for us, but on your way out, please do get to know Paula.
Well, good morning, church. It's good to see you all this morning. God, it's hot out today, isn't it? It's hot out every day. Why do I say that? Hello, everybody on Facebook and YouTube. Mom, Dad, kamusta na? And Tita over in Texas. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for blessing all of us, blessing this worship group to be able to put this music together and lift praise to you and let you know how much we love you, and blessing this congregation slash choir with the beautiful voices and the strength to help us lift these songs to you, Lord, and let you know how much we love you. And in your name we pray, amen. You know that question. Y'all ready for some praise? Wipe away your tears, child, there's no need to cry. Stand up on your feet now, lift your head up high. Don't wait for tomorrow, lay down your sorrow, freedom is here today. Wipe away those tears, child, put down your shame. Oh, I see an empty grave. Heavens waking, angels in jubilations. That stone's been rolled away. I feel the darkness breaking. I bet the devil's shaking. Somebody celebrate. I see an empty grave. Child, there's no need to cry. Stand up on your feet now, lift your head up high. Don't wait till tomorrow, lay down your sorrow, freedom is here today. Wipe away those tears, child, put down your shame. Oh, I see an empty grave. I hear the heavens waking, angels in jubilations. That stone's been rolled away. I feel the darkness breaking. I bet the devil's shaking. Somebody celebrate. I see an empty grave. On their faces when they saw that empty grave. He was gone. The ones that didn't believe, they were just like, whoa.
Wipe away those tears, child. Go and tell the news. What started in the garden was finished at the tomb. It's all been reversed. The apple, the curse. 3 days in the ground. Christ the Lord is risen. Death couldn't hold him down.
Yeah. That's right. That's right.
Oh, I see an empty grave. I hear the heavens waking, angels in jubilee. patience, that storm's been rolled away. I feel the darkness breaking, I bet the devil's shaking. Somebody celebrate, oh, I see an empty
I hear it roar, and I don't wanna fear the storm. I don't wanna fear the storm. Peace be still, say the word, and I will set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace be still, you are here, so it is. Trust the voice that speaks. Well, I'm not gonna be afraid, 'cause these waves are only waves. No, I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna fear the storm. You are greater than its roar. I'm not gonna fear the storm. No, I'm not gonna fear at all. Peace, be still. Say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace, be still. You are here, so it is well. Trust the voice that speaks. Peace, peace of mind. Oh, let your peace wash over me. Let faith rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me and in you. Let faith rise up, O heart, believe. Let faith rise up in me. Say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea. let your troubles go. He is with you. Feel his peace wash over you. The altar where I run to rest, where I wait resurrection and the touch of your breath. I die now daily so that I may live in the grace that belongs to who are born again. I am cleansed, I am washed, I am sanctified, I am Holy Ghost filled and water baptized. I am right with my God time, 'cause Jesus, my Savior's alive. Here at the table where children are fed, we are filled with the mercy of the Lamb and the bread.
Seated now as we go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for this opportunity this morning to come and gather in this place to experience all of these moments of worship as we sing your songs, as we pray to you, as we hear your words in Scripture. God, we pray that you would help move our hearts and minds. Help us to experience once again your wonder and your grace, and to know that you are working here in this place with us, through us, and for us. God, we all come this morning with burdens that we carry. We come with sorrows, we come with troubles, we come with doubts, we come with fears. God, we pray that you would help us to set those aside for this moment, to give us the hope and courage we need to take a step towards you and to experience all that you have for us. We ask this all in your holy name and pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, good morning. It is good to be in worship with all of you this morning. Before I get started, I want to thank everybody who has helped us with Hildreth Hall. I don't know if you know this, and we're going to have a ribbon cutting soon because it's not quite done yet. But eventually, we're going to have a ribbon cutting, and we're going to dedicate that building, rededicate it to the purpose it's using for. And I can't wait to show all of you that, but I can tell you this. Our kids are worshiping Jesus over there today, and it's incredible what so many of our volunteers and staff have been able to put together. So I just want to appreciate all of you for a moment. If you would show your appreciation for all of that. Today our sermon is going to kind of dovetail with a lot that's been going on here, and we're going to talk about what it means to take a faithful step. To take a faithful step knowing that you might not have all the answers, but to go where God is calling you anyway. And we're going to be looking in the book of Matthew. We're continuing with Jesus' miracles in Matthew. We're going to be in chapter 14, and we're going to be at verse 22. And it's the miracle of Jesus walking on the water. Now, before we get into it, you need to know this is happening right after Jesus has fed the 5,000. He's healed people. We talked about feeding the 5,000 last night, right? There's one thing that you can do to win a crowd over, and that's feed them a good meal. They'll get all kind of fired up. They don't want to leave. And so Jesus and his disciples are sending the crowds away, and the crowds are kind of becoming a problem. There's social unrest. John the Baptist is dead. There's a power vacuum, and Jesus is assuming the mantle of the one who is still leading this call to repentance and renewal forward. People are still flocking to hear it. And so Jesus is dispersing this massive crowd, and he's sending his disciples on ahead of him because, as we remember from last week, his grief for his cousin was interrupted, so he's going to go and find some solitude. And our scripture picks up there, and it says this: immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountains by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking to them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and started walking on water and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got onto the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, I can imagine the scene. I grew up being in this part of the world quite a bit of my life. My grandparents have always lived down here in Florida. My grandma and grandpa lived in Milton and in Pace. They lived in those places when I was growing up. So this was kind of my place where I would get exiled to from my parents' house for the summer because they were tired of dealing with me. And they'd send me to Grand Bonnie and Papa Rule, and I'd come back fat and happy because Grand Bonnie would feed us and Papa Rule would take us fishing. And we love to go fishing, and we go out on boats. And how many of you have ever been deep sea fishing? How many of you have done it when the weather was not great? That's my favorite kind. When I was a kid, I remember we went out on a boat, and we were given a bunch of Dramamine by my grandfather before we got on the boat. And we went, and we were fine. Nobody else on the boat was, but we caught the most fish ever that day. But I remember the waves and the wind and the sea, and it was still good enough for a boat to go out with a charter, but it was choppy, it was rough, and I can imagine with a boat going up and down and up and down, and we knew we were okay. I can imagine what it must have been like in a small boat on the Sea of Galilee, not knowing that you were going to be okay. Because boats in this time were not built to go out and do massive voyages. They planned travel around good weather patterns. They knew what time of year they could go out in boats and what time of year they could not. And most boats in this day and time were wind powered. So if the wind got wily, you didn't always have the ability to fight it. They didn't have modern boats like we have now. But even now, if you're out on certain sized boats and a storm comes, what do? You go back. You don't stay out there in the middle of that. You go back to shore. And these people, they spent most of their time in these boats when they'd see a storm blow up. They grounded the boats and got to shore because they didn't have the ability to deal with the storms. And if a boat ever got caught in a storm, it was a miraculous event if they made it out at all. And so these disciples on this boat who have been sent by Jesus to cross the Sea of Galilee, to go on ahead of him, and they come upon a storm and they are terrified. When I was a child, I watched these old shows. There were these old Hanna-Barbera cartoons, and one of them was about the storm and Jesus calming the storm, and it depicted these people hiding in the bottom of a boat because they were terrified of the wind and the waves. And I can imagine that these disciples were terrified. They were scared of everything that was going on around them. They were scared of the world around them. And there's a lot of symbology within the scripture as well. You see, the ocean, and it was always viewed as a chaotic force in the world. It was viewed as something that was unruly. It was untamable. There were all kinds of myths about the mythological creatures that would come and drag you to the depths of the sea. They knew the stories of krakens and of crazy sharks. And my boys love shark movies. They probably believed in the megalodon. Like, there's so much going on where their minds are playing tricks on them. They're terrified. And as this storm is blowing, as Jesus is not with them, as they're terrified, they see someone walking across this wind and these waves and this storm, walking across the ocean to them. And their mind does not go to, "Our salvation is here." Their mind goes to, "Oh no, we've already got a storm and now there's a ghost." Because people on boats are great at telling ghost stories. Disney's made a lot of money selling ghost stories on boats, the Pirates of the Caribbean. It's what people associate with, these crazy storms and these insane things happening at sea. And so their minds are going to all the myths that they've been told, and this figure is walking across. And Jesus says, "Y'all, calm down, it's me." Now they don't, right? They immediately question Jesus. How many of you are guilty for questioning Jesus, right? They question him. They're like, "Jesus, if it's you, prove it." And so Jesus says, "Well, Peter, come on out. Walk across the ocean to me. You'll be fine." And Peter gets out of the boat. and starts walking to Jesus, but he sinks, right? He looks around and sees everything. He knows the natural order of the world. He says, God, this isn't possible. And so he begins sinking. We're going to pause here in this miracle story because what Peter is going through is so like what so many faithful people go through. How often do we feel like we're in the middle of a storm on a boat? I can tell you, it doesn't take long. If you really want to be negative, all you have to do is go look up what's going on in the world and go watch your favorite news source. I promise you, they're all going to tell you that the world is ending, but in new and exciting, colorful ways. But they're going to tell you all the negative things that are happening because negativity sells, right? It's the old rule of saying in marketing classes when I was at Huntington College was that good news, one person will tell about three people that they had a good experience at a business. But if someone has a bad experience, they're going to tell everybody they know because that's the way it goes. And our world news is that way. We very often skip over the positive things and highlight the negative things. We do that, and some of that is it gets more clicks, it gets more views. People tune into that more. And so there is this idea that we let the chaos in our lives rise up around us. The ocean was essentially an embodiment of chaos in ancient times, and this story of these disciples being out in the middle of chaos is one that applies to our lives. It's one that teaches us something deep about what it means to be faithful because they were on a boat in the middle of the most chaotic moment. And I would argue that we as people of faith, if we allow our lives to look like this, feel like we're adrift in a boat in the middle of chaos. So much so that one of the things that culture has started doing is isolating itself. I remember vividly at my grandparents' house in Milton, they were front porch people. You know what I mean by that? Most people now hang out on their back porch. They don't hang out on their front porch. But my grandparents sat on the front porch, and all the neighbors sat on their front porch. And all of us kids during the summertime would run around like a mob. I remember the old movie Dennis the Menace. We were like a mob of kids running around a neighborhood, playing hide-and-go-seek, playing wiffle ball, throwing water balloons at each other, throwing water balloons at the people on the porches, and running because that was the right thing to do in those moments. But I remember vividly that culture and that community. But as I go to visit my grandmother now, everyone's in their backyard. No one's in their front yard. And I'm willing to bet that it kind of feels like that instead of leaning into this idea that the best way to face the chaos is to step out on and overcome it, we've all decided that we're going to hide in the relative safely of whatever boat we have. Even the way we build houses has changed. Our house that we have has a garage you can drive into and park. You can close the garage behind you. You can walk in the house and never deal with your neighbors. It is a beautiful trick if you have bad neighbors. I don't. I like my neighbors. But I think about this as we think about the way we've developed our culture. We've become the kind of people who like to accentuate our comfort more than we care about dealing with the problems that are all around us. We're afraid to take a step. We would rather huddle in our sinking ship than make a difference. We hide from the problems of the world. We decide that the best possible answer is to become reclusive, to go hide in places where people only look, think, and act just like us. But there's no transformation in the world when you do that. Jesus never did that. In fact, he disrupted his life constantly to go out where the need was, to go out where the chaos was, to bring peace to the chaos. And so as he walks out to his disciples, who have literally just seen Jesus feed 5,000 people with next to nothing, and he tells them, I'm walking on water to come and get you and help you. They don't believe him. They freak out. But Peter, the rock on which the church is going to be built, says, Jesus, if it's you, command me, and I will come out and meet you. Jesus gives the command and Peter makes it part of the way. And so many people look at this miracle and they focus on the failure of Peter, right? So many people are like, oh, you gotta have faith, you gotta have this. Think about the faith that must have taken to step out of the only real safety you had into the water. I look at this and think, man, Peter is a hero. because he was at least willing to take the step. Did he end up doing everything perfect? No, he started looking around and getting distracted by the chaos around him and started to sink. But that was a lesson for Peter. That was a lesson that Jesus was teaching all of his disciples who would later become apostles and would have to be the living body of Christ in the world, just like we are today. He was teaching him, you gotta stay focused on the mission. You gotta stay focused on who you're called to be. You gotta stay focused on what you're called to be doing. You have to be willing to take a faithful step and then follow that with another faithful step. If you start looking around and worrying about the chaos, you're gonna sink. You have to rise above it. Because the thing that's amazing about Jesus is that he doesn't just stay above the chaos, he calms it. He calms the storm, right? He tells it, in another telling of this story, it says that Jesus rebukes the wind. Have you ever yelled at the wind? I mean, I'm sure we live in Florida. We would love to yell at the wind from time to time, right? The first week I was here, day one, we put a tent together. Day two, we watched the wind destroy said tent. Christine was not happy. But I think about this idea that God is so much greater than all the problems we make massive. And that if we focused on taking our faithful steps, that man, we could bring peace and tranquility to a chaotic world. So what does that look like? Well, it looks like being involved. It looks like taking that faithful step to say yes to something within the life of your church. We're about to launch Wednesday night suppers. I need all of you on your connect cards to write, I cannot wait to cook and clean for Wednesday night suppers. I need you to also write, I would love to teach a small group. I also need you to write, you know, children and youth are my favorite people. I want to volunteer with them. I need you to write that I would love to go out and compassionately care for our elders in our church who need a little bit of help. I need you to write in there that I would love to be a part of a prayer team that prays for people each and every week, because we need every single one of us taking faithful steps if we're going to transform the world. Because friends, we're not here as a church to be transformed by the world. We're here as a church, as followers of Jesus Christ, to bring Jesus into the world and the world to be transformed in Jesus's image. The United Methodist Church's whole purpose of being, our mission statement, is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, not for our comfort and ease. But that means that we're gonna have to be willing to step out into the chaos every now and then. But to be the kind of people who can calm it down just by our presence, knowing that God is with us, knowing that God is walking with us. The Apostle Paul, in the book of Romans, understood the need for people to understand what they were called to. Because so often we don't truly understand what we're called to be. But the Apostle Paul in Romans, he's talking about salvation, but he's talking about how it's achieved. And he says that salvation is for all. In Romans 10, beginning with verse 5, he says this: Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. Therefore, there is no distinction between Jew or Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and generous to all who call him. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And it's important for us to hear this scripture in tandem with this idea of stepping out in faith, because so often one of the things that we say is, oh, the pastor's talking to someone else. He's not talking to me because I am not the kind of person he would maybe want going and helping with these ministries. I have these sins in my life. I have these issues in my life that maybe I shouldn't be the right one. Or I have these disabilities where I can't do these things with these kinds of people. Or I am too busy. Or that's just not my favorite thing. Have y'all ever made excuses to not do something? Just me. Just, all right. Thanks for letting me hang on my own. Appreciate it. Sinners. But really, we're called to understand that we are all called. It doesn't say, Paul is telling them, he's telling them there is no distinction between any of us, that we are all called, not only for salvation, but to be in ministry. We're all equally valued to God. I am not more valuable to God than you. In fact, I am deeply unsuccessful for God without you. Without you using what God has given you, and not without you coming alongside the ministries we plan for our church, without you helping me develop new ministries for our church, we don't stand a chance. Because God doesn't call just a staff of people to do the work of the Lord. God calls all of his disciples to be active and engaged in ministry. To be the kind of people who understand that we are all called to take that step of faith out of the boat. To step out into the chaos that exists in the world, that regardless of who we are or where we came from or what our backstory is, that God has called us and that we are enough. We are enough to change the world. And friends, we may not change the national politics, and we're coming up on an election cycle, the Lord be with you. But we can change the world for people around us. I've had people change my world just by coming alongside me and loving me where I was. I've had people love me through things that I thought I couldn't get through. I've had people ask me to do things that I knew I couldn't do, but they stood there right next to me while we accomplished things for God that I thought were impossible. But man, what would it be like if we all started taking steps of faith together? What would it be like if our entire church decided that we were all going to become on fire for the mission and ministry that God is calling this church to? What would it be like if we got to experience truly the transformative power of the grace of God because we were all walking faithfully in the places that God was calling us to go? Because friends, God doesn't always call us to go to the easiest places, amen? We're called to go out into the chaos. We're called to walk out there. I mean, we even have to do ministry with Alabama fans. It's tough. And they say things like Roll Tide and, you know, it's hard. And then those Seminoles fans doing this number and the Gator Chomp. I mean, y'all, I'm going to pray for all y'all. But War Eagle. But but there is this sense in which we all have to find ways to rally together. We have to put our divisions aside for the sake of the kingdom of God. We have to put the things that cause us to feel like our life is chaos on the back burner and to put the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ first. When we do that, we'll change the world. Because I'm gonna go ahead and tell you, friends, when we start doing mission and ministry in a transformative way, people are going to want to be a part of what we're doing. People are going to want to come and see and experience and taste the goodness of God, to be a part of a community of God that upholds one another, that loves each other, that is a part of faithfully hanging in there with one another, even through our differences, even through our struggles, even when we don't think, act, look, or talk the same, we are still called by the same God. One of the miracles of church is that it's a place where different people from every walk of life come together and acknowledge that we are all the same. We are broken and flawed people who are made perfect by the grace and love and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We all hold that in common, and that is the most significant thing about us. Everything else that God gives us is gravy. And so friends, I'm encouraging you today, I need you to look around this church and see where you plug in. If you don't see the ministry you want, either write what you want on that Connect card or come and talk to me. Call me. My cell phone is not a secret. It's 850-287-2717. I reserve the right to send you to voicemail. But I will call you back. But some of what we have to do is get busy doing the work of God. being the family of Christ that walks faithfully together. Only when we do that will this church reach the potential it has. Because friends, there's no limit to what we can do. God has given us a beautiful sanctuary, an incredible campus. We are in a place where everybody on earth, it feels like, drives by our church. I don't know if you've noticed the traffic on 98, but it's a lot. And we can make a difference. But it's going to take us all working together. But I think we can do it. I think we can change the world one soul at a time. And eventually that adds up and we'll change Navarre. And that'll change all of West Florida. And that'll change all of Florida. That'll change the country and change the world just because of the faithfulness of a few. You can do it because God is with us. And Jesus proved walking on that storm, nothing is impossible. He is over the chaos in the world. When we walk with Jesus, anything can happen. The Apostle Paul tells us that later in the book of Romans, in chapter 10, he says, you know, the people who carry the good news out in the world, those people have beautiful feet. That's a weird saying, isn't it? But he says that we have beautiful feet, and what he's saying is that we're all called to be the kind of people who have the willingness to take those steps, to have beautiful feet that walk with the faithfulness of Christ, carrying the message of Christ with us everywhere we go, letting the message of Christ transform how we not only interact with people who we know are faithful, but interact how we interact with people who don't know Christ. When we do those things, God is glorified, lives are saved and changed, and the world is made a better place because we are in it. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this opportunity to gather as people. We pray, God, that you would help us to be the kind of people who have faith that changes the world. Help us to not be afraid to take the next faithful step, but to be the kind of people who have these beautiful feet that in each step seek to glorify you. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. I invite our ushers to come forward now for our time of offering.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I know my author of my sorrow's ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust in. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust in. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. I sought the Lord, and He heard, and He answered. That's why I trust Him. That's why I trust in. I sought the Lord.
Unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
The Holy Spirit is huge. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
That's right. Worthy is the Lamb who's slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who's slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. I am sitting between like two of the greatest moments in my life. I mean, thank you, Lord. I love you so much. Last week, August 8th, I celebrated my one-year anniversary as your worship leader. Woo-hoo-hoo! They say time flies when you're having fun, and I'm having a blast, and it just seems like you swore me in 2 days ago. And then the other one, this Wednesday, my wife and I are going to be celebrating 10 years of marriage. I love you, Christina. And the only thing that keeps going through my head is, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh, you lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done.